standing as we sing our call to worship?
Couldn't have timed that no better, could I? Hey, even a blind hog find an acorn every now and again. Hey, I hope everybody's doing okay this morning. A lot of announcements this morning, but I want to start by saying, do we have any first-time visitors this morning to Asaville Baptist Church? All right, well, you officially welcome, and we got a couple of bags of goodies we're going to give y'all, and y'all come back anytime. We're pretty informal around here, though, so if you're looking for something very formal, suit and tie, this ain't your place, but we're glad to have you this morning, tickled to have you. Want to start by saying, you know, y'all see all these shoe boxes up here. So we're packaging these up, and if you'll look on them, I'm not going to reach down and pick them up. But they got different ages, age groups. It's for boys and girls, and they'll be shipped. Where are they going to go to this time? Do you know?
I guess
Randall. Okay. We don't know where they're going. But you, yeah, they go into somebody who needs them. But here's the thing. So you'll get a little tracking. You'll get a little tracking number on there, and you can keep track of it, and you'll find out where it went to. How about that? But this is Samaritan's Purse, right? And these are going to be due. All of these, once you get them filled up, will be due on the 17th. And get with Randall or Janice about this. Yeah, go ahead. Next Sunday here, we'll have our fall festival, and I know that a lot of you were preparing to go tonight to Delahoe to help out down there. I don't see Eric. There's Eric, way back there. And I'm sure y'all still have plenty of folk down there, but we're going to throw this out. Being as a lot of things were unexpected, what took place this week, as all of you know, Preacher D's father passed away. They're having a service today at 2. excuse me, got something going on this morning, but anyway, so we're going to word it like this. If you still want to go to Delahoe and do their, it's going to be like a trunk or treat, if I understand it right. Right, Eric? If you want to go, you're more than welcome to go, but we were saying as a church, we just feel like we need to support our pastor and be here for the funeral today. So surely Eric and Delahoe will understand what took place, you know, this weekend, unforeseen circumstances there. But you feel free to go. If you've got young ones and y'all been drumming it up all week and wanting to go, y'all go right ahead. They'll still be down there, and I'm sure there'll be plenty of goodies and all that good stuff. November 10th will be our one-day revival. Brother D's got that all planned, and we've been kind of pushing it. So November the 10th, one-day revival. And that'll be morning and evening, right, D? For those of you that don't know, haven't looked behind you, our pastor is here today, so I could be fired on the spot and go right back to where I come from, right? Anyway, long story short, the Down East Boys, they'll be here on the 14th. If you like good gospel singing, you come on. I'm sure you'll enjoy that. And we've got several that we need to be in prayer for. Rebecca, Dwight here this morning, Mr. Shipman back there. We need to be praying for these folks. They're fighting a battle, and we need to keep them in our prayers daily, multiple times daily. And once again, if this is your first time here, we just want to make you feel as welcome as we know how. We appreciate you coming our way this morning. Does anybody have anything that I did not mention? Hi. You know what? I only looked at my list. I'm sorry. Okay. Okay. Did y'all all hear that? The Friday night? Well, you. Okay, I see it now. I'm looking everywhere and finally see it, and it's bold and colored in purple. How did I miss that? But anyway, that's Friday, November 15th at 6 p.m. Baked potato, salad bar, if you didn't hear, and crafts, $10 to cover the cost of the crafts. Sign-up sheets up front, I'm assuming over here somewhere. And like I say, if you feel led to be a part of that, you come on, sign up, and, hey, bring you $10. Don't forget your $10. But anyway, if there's anything else, I think I saw Eden's hand. And if y'all have any leftover candy after Halloween, I think Macy will take it and Tinley will take it. I know them two well enough to say that they'll take any leftover candy you got. And if you just can't eat it all, they'll help you out. They rob Preacher D every Sunday of his candy back there. So anyway. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we do thank you for today. And Lord, we're just so grateful that you allowed us to come here today and worship you. And Lord, would you be with Preacher D and his family? Lord, would you be with Miss Patsy in a very special way this morning? Would you just wrap your arms of love and comfort around them? And Lord, just guide them through these days of grief. And Lord, just strengthen them as you see fit. And Lord, we lift up Dwight and Miss Becca and Mr. Shipman. Lord, we lift these folk up and just pray that you would touch them in a very special way. I pray you would let them feel your presence here even this morning. And Lord, just be with them in the days to come. Give their families strength to help them in the days to come. And Lord, help us as a church family to pray for these folk every day, daily. Lord, just help us to be the servants, the Christians that you would have us to be. Lord, forgive us where we failed you. I pray you would be with our brother Randall as he brings the message here in just a few moments. Would you just speak through him the words we need to hear? Would you calm his doubts and fears? And Lord, just let him boldly proclaim your word here in the next hour. And Lord, this prayer we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, standing as we sing our offertory song, please.
Oh, how he
kids can go to children's church and everybody can shake hands and welcome everybody, please.
Is it on?
Okay.
This song is actually for me and Dwight and Rebecca and whoever and Mr. Shipman, but it's for everybody, really. And it's called Worry Ends Where Faith Begins.
About tomorrow and what the future holds. Your mind is filled with questions as you face the unknown. You spent so many sleepless nights trying to work it out. Worry has consumed your faith with all its fear and doubt. Faith begins. Why should we ever worry? Why should we fret at all? When worry only hinders the mighty hand of God. He says it is impossible to please him without faith. So lay aside your worry, walk on in Jesus' name.
Good morning. Let's open up in prayer. Father, we just thank you for today, God. We just thank you for just allowing us to come in your house, God, just worship you this morning, God. And I just pray for this hour, God. I pray for this service. I pray, God, that we would move any distraction that we have right now in our minds and our hearts, God. We would just move it, get it out of the way, God, and then we could just hear you speak this morning. We do lift up all these. Man, we heard a lot of sickness, a lot of families that lost loved ones, God, in our church, in our community. We lift them up to you today, God, in a special way and ask you just to be with them, God. Just be with me this morning, God. Just hide me behind your cross. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. All right, everybody excited to be here? I'm super excited this morning. So Miss Dorothy caught me coming in this morning. I had me a nice energy drink. I drank some of Crystal's energy drink, and I've had me a full energy drink. So I am ready to go this morning. So I might talk faster than I normally do, Mr. Dwight, so y'all better hold on. So look, I only got 8 pages of notes today, and I don't know if I'll use them all or not. So if I had to title my message today, it would be When Asked, Don't Say No. Now, when you think about that, there are things that we should say no to, right? If somebody come up and offered you some drugs today, you better say no, right? If one of your friends, young people, old person, whoever it is today, comes up to you and wants you to go do something that you know is wrong, what do you better do? You better say no, right? But if God comes to you and he tells you you need to do this, you better do it. It might not make sense, but one day it will. So today, when we look in the Bible, we can see, man, Jesus interacted with a lot of people throughout the Bible. We can see it on and on anywhere we look. But there was one interaction that I've read before and looked at, and we all know it. It's about the rich young ruler. And you know, this interaction must be pretty important because I can see it in Matthew, I can see it in Mark, and I can see it in Luke. So it must be pretty important. Show of hands. When I say rich, young, or ruler? Who wants to be rich? Nobody? Good. There you go. Who wants to be young? Who wants to be a ruler? I do see some hands. Some of you's not lying to me this morning. Right? We all say, yep, I want to be rich. Think about it, though. When you think about rich people, what do you see sometimes? You see a lot of them's got a lot of problems. So do we really want that? I don't know. Right? We had some show of hands, want to be young. Right? Sure, we all want to be younger again. I'd love to be younger again. If I could take that wisdom that I have now and build it on every day and go back to I was 19 or 20, man, just think what God could have done if I would have been so sold out as a 19 or 20-year-old. Imagine. What about a ruler? Kind of wish maybe a ruler. You see some of the headaches they go through, all the work they're having to do, so maybe not. You know, this story of the rich young ruler who came to Jesus with a very important question. I want to point out something right here. Look at me. Jesus loves it. He loves it when we bring our questions to him. I tell these young people all the time, ask him. Why not? He already knows. He already knows what you're thinking. Even when you don't understand it, go ahead and ask him. Why not? He knows it. The cool thing is, you know, sometimes you ask your parents too many questions and they get tired of listening to you, right? Well, this, well, that, well, why, well, this, well, that, right? Over and over and over and over, right? Parents, I was probably that kid. I feel sure I was that kid. I'm 100% positive I was that kid. You know, he don't rebuke us. He don't slap us in the face. He don't get angry at us. This is part of what it means for God to be sovereign. He already knows everything. He's totally in control of everything. You know, I have a lot of questions all the time. I have things that don't make sense to me a lot. God is doing something and working and asking me and telling me some stuff right now, and I'm like, what are you talking about? It's scary. But he don't rebuke us for it. You know, in this story, the rich young ruler comes to Jesus with a very specific question. And Jesus does his best, right? He's perfect, to give him an answer. If no one ever told you guys, look at me. Young people, look at me. I just said it. It's okay to ask Jesus. I'd rather you ask Jesus than even some of the best Christian people you know. Because I'm going to do my best to give you my godly advice, but I'm still probably going to put my human perspective in it. And if I ask Jesus, what is Jesus going to do? He's going to give me the right answer. It might not be the answer I'm looking for, but he's going to give me the right answer. He's not offended when we don't understand. He expects that from us. He made me, he made you. And when you think about, man, there's so much unknown and so much uncertainty going on in our community, in our state, in our country, in our world. Look at it. Turn on the news. There's so much uncertainty. Mr. Jesse asked me a while ago, he said, you got any anxiety this morning? I'm like, yes, sir, I sure do. Youth, what did I speak on Wednesday night with you? We talked about anxiety. I told you, other than Jesus, he's the only one that didn't have it. Everybody else carries it. I'm carrying it a little this morning. We carry fear. We carry frustration all around us. And here's what we do sometimes. The right place to take this anxiety and stuff isn't to a bottle. And that's what a lot of people do. Right? It isn't to these pills you can take. That's not it. Right? It's Jesus. Point blank. That's what it is. You can go hunt for it everywhere else. I promise you. You can hunt for it in money. We're going to talk about it today. You can hunt for it in fame. You can hunt for it in whatever. And it's going to leave you I promise. We can bring it to Jesus. And that's what the rich young ruler did this morning. When we read that, he brought it to Jesus. Look at it in verse 18. So sorry, I don't even know if I said what I was going to be in. I apologize. I'm in Luke 18 this morning. Starting in verse 18, I'll be 18 through 30. Mine's a little different. I'm preaching out of the CSV this morning. This is a New American Standard, but it's close. Look at it right here in verse 18. A ruler asked him, "Good teacher." So let me talk. Let me stop right there. Good teacher. If we look at that in the original language and or the Hebrew, it means rabbi. So we come to Jesus, right? Good teacher. The rich young ruler acknowledged Jesus for his authority. Good teacher. Look at verse 18 still. A ruler asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Now, if I stop right there, and if we made a top 10 list of the most important questions me or you could ask God, probably number one, the most important, how can I truly be saved? Young people, we talked a little bit about that the other night, didn't we? If you met God today, and he asked you, "Why should I let you into heaven?" What would you say? What would you say? Think about it. What would you say? Look at verse 19. So Jesus asked him a question. "Why do you call me good? Why do you call me good?" Jesus asked him. Look at this. "No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. Don't commit adultery. Don't murder. Don't steal. Don't bear false witness. Honor your father and your mother." Look how the rich young ruler responds. Verse 21. "I've kept all of these from my youth." He literally gives us an insight to what he's thinking right here. Right? "I've kept all of them. I've kept all of these." He literally thought that he had kept the law perfectly. Look at verse 22. When Jesus heard this, he told him, "You still lack one thing. Sell all you have, distribute it to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, and what does it say? Follow me." There's a sequence right here. Jesus is answering this guy's question, right? But he's answering in sequence. He's saying there's something between me and you that's causing some issues. How many of you got something between you and Jesus that's causing issues today? Right? We all have them. Jesus is telling, there's something, listen to this is hard. There's something you have to be willing to do and walk away from to follow me. Man, that's scary right there. What if that means, hey, I'm going to load up from Anderson, South Carolina, that I lived for 49 years, and he says, "I want you to go to California and be a pastor." Who's going today? Anybody signing up? Ain't nobody. I got people laughing out here. Ain't nobody signing up. Could he do that? Absolutely. Is he scary? Absolutely. After he heard this, look at verse 23. After he heard this, He became extremely sad because he was very rich. Look at verse 24 through 26. Seeing that, he became sad. Jesus said, "How hard is it for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God? For it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than a rich person to enter the kingdom of God." Look at verse 26. So, the disciples are around when this is going on, so they're hearing it, right? Verse 26, so those who heard asked this question. Then who can be saved? That's their thought. Who can be saved? They were thinking, man, if it's hard for a rich person to be saved, then who can be saved? It feels impossible. Look in verse 28. Old Peter. I love Peter. You know why I love Peter? Because I'm a lot like Peter. He don't really hide anything, does he? You know, he kind of just speaks it like it is. You always know what's going on in his mind. Man, Peter gives me hope. Let's look at Peter. What did he say in verse 28? Then Peter said, "Look, we have left what we had to follow you." Subtext here. I'm gonna put it in just blunt English. He's saying, "Aren't we awesome, Jesus? We get to go to heaven. Man, we left our fishing boats, right? We left all of our nets. We left our family business. Aren't you proud of me, Jesus?" Anybody ever act like that? Let's be real. We do. Don't lie to yourself this morning. We all do it. I'm guilty of it every day. Then verse 29 and 30. So he said to them, "Truly, I tell you, there is no one who has left a house, wife or brothers or sisters, parents or children, because of the kingdom of God, who will not receive many times more at this time and eternal life in the age to come." So the rich young ruler, he's got a question. And Jesus gave an answer. And it wasn't the answer he was looking for. Right? You know, here it just says, if we go back to the first verse in 18, it says a ruler asked him, right? But if we look in Matthew and Mark, it does say a rich young ruler. He had great wealth. He was the boss. He was in charge, right? The kids these days, they would say, "This man is standing on business." Now, some of us people don't get that. But when I listen to these kids talk and I go to these conferences, that means something. I'll have to ask somebody what it means sometime or another. But he had his affairs in order, he thought. He's the kind of guy in that culture that had servants, people that worked for him, and he would tell people, "Go do this," and guess what they would do? They'd go do it. He had some status, right? But he comes to Jesus with a question. What do I have to do to have eternal life? Right off the bat, we see this guy had the right approach. He had the right approach, right? How do I know this? Because he calls him good teacher. So he had the right approach. He come to Jesus with the right approach. He comes to Jesus with a level of respect, a level of honor. He's honoring who Jesus is. He knew what Jesus' reputation was, right? He knew Jesus had influence. Jesus was starting to gain fame. Now, Jesus didn't want that, right? He didn't come to the earth for fame. We want fame. Jesus didn't want that, right? He didn't come for fame. He knew what he was coming for. He was coming to die on a cross, a cruel death for you, for me, for everybody. That's why he come. He knew that, but he was gaining fame. Because they started hearing all these miracles and raising people from the dead and all of this, that, and the other, right? So he comes to Jesus with the right approach. Good teacher. Now, the right approach is everything. Wives, if you want your husband to do something, okay, You got to approach them the right way. For Debbie to get Billy to do something, and Billy's not here today, so I can pick on Billy, right? Right? Debbie knows she's got to approach him the right way to get him to do something. Look at her. She's shaking her head. Yes, back there, I bet. You got to approach it. Husbands, when you messed up, you screwed up. If you hadn't done it already today, you're going to do it probably before the end of the day or sometime this week, right? It's all about the right approach. You know what you got to do? Maybe it's flowers. Got to get her some flowers. Maybe it's a gift card to whatever their favorite store is. I don't know. It's all about the approach. So when the rich young ruler, he said, good teacher, what do I have to do? He has the right approach, but let me show you what he misses right here. In that question is embedded pride. Sometimes this is how we approach Jesus. What did he say? What do I have to do? I, me. That's what we live in a world today. Right? It's all about me. It's all about you. And if it ain't, it's wrong. If it ain't, well, you don't like me. That's the world we live in. His approach was right, but pride in his approach was what was wrong. He said, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Here's where we mess up sometimes. We actually think that we can do something to save ourselves. We do. We get caught up because we can do some good stuff. We think, oh, we're doing good works, right? Oh, I'm serving as a youth pastor. I could serve as a youth pastor and hit hell wide open today if I didn't have a relationship with Jesus Christ. And that's where I think we as the church get it wrong. Let's be real. I think I told my Sunday school this class a few weeks ago, or it might have been the youth. I don't remember who it was. We live in the South, so what do? Everybody's saved. Everybody's saved. Right? Everybody's saved in Abbeville, South Carolina, and Iva, South Carolina, and Anderson, South Carolina. That's what we think. Go ask somebody today. You know Jesus? What are they going to tell you? Yeah, I know Jesus. Exactly what they're going to say. I know Jesus. This guy right here knew Jesus, didn't he? We think we can actually do good enough to earn our salvation. I can keep the rules that God has, and he'll let me into the kingdom. If I do good enough, I can get into heaven. My good outweighs my bad, so I should be able to get in heaven. Hear me today. The word of God is clear. We are not saved by anything that we do. You can't do a good enough good works to get into heaven today. Now, don't get me wrong, right? I think when you're saved, you want to do some good stuff, right? I would think so. But if that's all you're doing, there are good people. There are good people that I know. Good people that you know would give you the shirt off their back today. But if they died today, they'd spend eternity in hell. Right? It doesn't mean that what we do don't matter. Because it does, right? We're not saved by our good deeds. We're only saved because Jesus did the ultimate good deed when he died on the cross. And he took the place that each one of us in here deserved, right? And he gave us a way out. He gave us a way back to God because we were the one that messed it up to start with. Rich young ruler. He was used to doing things with his power, with his wealth. We don't have to do anything to save ourselves. We can't, right? We're only saved by grace. God doesn't love you because of your behavior. God doesn't love you because you're good. He loves you because he's good. Man, this guy was so filled with pride that he thought he could do something to earn God's love. We can't earn God's love. It's already been given to you free of charge. It was paid in full. Something else about this guy that I noticed. He had the right posture. Posture's important. When you weren't a religious leader in the first century and you approached a rabbi, your posture should be of humility. Look at me, young people. When you approach adults, you come with respect. You don't come with the garbage you get in school today, and you don't come with the garbage your other friends do. You come to them with respect. You come to them with honor. That's what this guy did right here. He understood who he was in the presence of. His question right here was all about eternal life. Listen to what he's not saying, but he kind of is saying. He's saying, I've accomplished everything. Got money. I got barns. I got servants. But you know what? He knew he was missing something. He knew he was missing peace. He had it all, and he wasn't happy. See it all the time, right? Kids, you look at these pro athletes or these movie stars, and you think, man, they got it all. They got it all. And when you start reading stories about it, you realize they ain't happy because money ain't going to buy it. The rich young ruler knew he was missing peace. He had it all, and he wasn't happy. He reached the top of the mountain, but he was absolutely empty. He was. Nothing was making him happy. All the lands, all the farms, all the money, all the servants, none of it was making him happy. There was no amount of money that could buy this guy a good night's sleep. He knew he was missing something. He knows he needed to be right with God. He knew he was a sinner. He came to Jesus because he knew Jesus could answer it. So his posture was right. He come to Jesus the right way. But he had the right posture, but he had the wrong perspective. He thought, what did he say? What can I do to inherit eternal life? So he thought he could inherit salvation. So he's saying, what can I do? When I studied a little bit, and I'm not 100% sure, but we talk about him being what? We talk about him being young. And when you look in the original Greek, and when I was studying and looking at some other pastors, the impression is here that maybe he had inherited all of his stuff from his father. He's being young. And I don't know that to be true or not. What I was studying, that's just kind of maybe what we could take there when I look at it. Him being young, you would think potentially that could be. If that's the case, he kind of tips his hat as to why he came to Jesus that way. Right? And my dad passed it on to me. I didn't have to do nothing for it. It was given to me. We got kids all in our culture today. That's how they think because their parents give them everything. Let's be real, guys. I'm guilty of that. I was guilty of that. We all want better for our kids. I was guilty of it. Jesus, can you tell me, from a rabbi's perspective, what do I have to do to inherit eternal life? That's what he asked. So Jesus knew his perspective was wrong. That's why Jesus said, tell me this. Have you kept the laws? That's what he asked him, basically, right? And then what did he do? He lists off a number of commandments where he said, do not commit adultery. Don't murder. Don't steal. Don't bear false witness. Honor your father and your mother. So Jesus lists some of the commandments that deal with other people. So right there, he was exposing that young man's heart. It's what he was doing. He's rich, and there are poor people all around him. And maybe he hadn't been helping them. He hadn't shared. He had plenty. Jesus wants to change his perspective. He says, you can't inherit eternal life. Look at this. You're not a Christian because you're born in a Christian family. That don't make you a Christian, young people. You're not a Christian because you sit in church every Sunday, and if you decide to come back on Sunday night, and boy, if I come on Wednesday night, right? That's what we think. That don't make you a Christian. I can tithe every week above and beyond. That don't make you a Christian. I could vote the right way. Got something important coming up. I could vote the right way. That don't make me a Christian. I could even believe the right thing on all of these social issues that we see out here today. That still don't make me a Christian. Well, my mom and dad's a Christian. Young people, that don't make you a Christian. I get into heaven because I heard the gospel, I repented of my sin, and I believed what Jesus done is true, and he's not still hanging on that cross. Every Sunday morning I sit here and I get focused on that cross right there. What a better place to have a cross. I love that. I love a lot about this church, but I sit there on that pew right there and I look at that cross. And I think every Sunday, man, what he done for me. I didn't deserve it. I didn't deserve it at all. But he done it anyway. Aren't we glad? He done it anyway. I wasn't born into the family of God. I was reborn into the family of God. That makes sense? I hope it does. His posture was right. His perspective was off. Jesus wants to change his perspective. Another thing about this guy, he had the right answers. Man, he knew what to say. Oh my gosh. I love this. This is what we live in today, right? Yeah, he had the right answers. He knew exactly what to say. Man, Jesus rattled off some of those commandments in verse 20. And look what he said in verse 21. He said, I kept all of these from my youth. He knew the right thing to say. He knew the churchy thing to say, right? That's the right answer. That's what you think you should say in that moment, right? So he thought he said the right answer in that moment. Subtext here again. He said, I'm a pretty good guy, Jesus. I kept all of these. Wow, he missed it. Man, he was tone deaf. He was arrogant. I'm not broken any of these. But the cool thing is, Jesus didn't turn him away. He could have. He didn't turn him away. He didn't even judge him. We're judging him, right? That's what we're going to do. We're going to judge him. Because it's easier to judge somebody else than to look at my own garbage and messed up stuff I got in my own life. A lot of us think this way. A lot of us think Jesus is just sitting there waiting to say, ha ha, got you. He ain't. That's not the case. See, Jesus knew the rich young ruler's heart, right? He knew where he was at. So he's trying to help him. He's trying to help him understand here. That's what he does for us. Even though the rich young ruler has all the right answers, I want to show you what he missed. He missed the right action. He had the right answers, but he had the wrong action. Jesus goes right to the heart right here. He says, one thing you lack. He's telling them, sell all you got, give your money to the poor, and come follow me. That's what he said. And what did the rich young ruler do? He went away sad. He had all the right answers, but he had the wrong action. I want us to be careful that we don't have the all the right answers, but lack the action of faith. We know the right thing to say. We know how to speak Christian lingo. We know all the cliches. That question I asked my guys the other night, if he asked you today, why should I let you in? You know what they put? They put the right answer. They did. They put the Christian cliche. Well, right? I know I'm saved. I know he died on the cross for my sins. Accurate. Yep. I know we're still not there. I know he rose again. It's the right thing. But he wants to know what's personal in your heart. The only way we get to Jesus is because he shed his blood for me and you. Right? Make it personal. Don't give the proper answer. We bad about that. We want to give the proper answer. Why don't we go to the Bible and what the Bible says? Maybe it offends you. Maybe it steps on your toe. Maybe you don't like what I say. But I ain't telling you. God told you. I get stepped on all the time. All the time. Matter of fact, every time I open the Bible, he steps on my toes. I get stepped on a lot. Because I think I'm like this guy. I think I'm doing good. I get caught up in me, me, me. And it's about him, him, him. Not me, me, me. Here's an example. Somebody comes up to you, will you pray for me? And what do we say? Yeah, I'll pray for you. But let me ask you this. You got the right answer, but do you follow up with the right answer? How many times do you say, I'm going to pray for you, and then when you walk away because 9 million other things is going on, you forget to do it? Am I the only one like that? Last point here. We see one snapshot of this guy's life. That's all we read about him. One snapshot. He had the right approach. He had the right posture. He had the right answers, but he had the wrong affection. Everything was right with his encounter with Jesus. Everything was right. He approached in the right way. He had the right posture. He even had the right answers. But how did he miss it? He loved his money more than he loved the man standing in front of him. And I'm talking about money, and I'm talking about rich, but what do you love more? Put it personal. What do you love more than the man right in front of you? Because if you put anything in front of him, you love something more. Right? It's not me. I'm telling you what the Bible says this morning. His wealth, he loved his wealth more than to worship the Son of God. He loved his possessions more than giving them up to follow Jesus. Here's where the rubber meets the road right here, guys. Jesus, he don't want our money. Right? If he wanted it, you know what he'd do? He'd take it from me. He don't want it. If you just give in because you think the Christian cliche, the Bible telling you that's the right thing, and you just say, oh, I got to give my tithe this month, and it don't mean nothing, then you know what? God can use it more if somebody come down here and we read about in the Bible, and all they had is $1 bill, and they know if they gave this dollar bill that they ain't going to be able to get them a Pepsi Cola today. And they gave it to them. You know, God could use that more than somebody that gives $10,000 out of their own heart. I'm just, again, we have to give out of the right heart. He don't want our wallet. He wants this right here. He wants our heart. He wanted the rich young ruler to walk away and follow him. And when I get looking through the Bible and stuff, I kind of look at different stories, and I kind of compare some of these stories, and I think about, you know, Abraham and Isaac. He was willing. He said, are you willing to sacrifice your son? And Abraham was, right? Because he trusted God so much that he knew he could raise him from the dead if he wanted to. Right? Jacob and Esau. I was reading that, studying it a little bit. Esau, the oldest son, birthright was his, right? And what did he do? Working all day, hungry. His appetite in the moment, he was willing to forego his birthright for a flipping bowl of soup. So many other stories in the Bible. Jesus is trying to make a point. He's telling, don't trade your birthright for a bowl of soup. And I seen a statement, C.S. Lewis said it. He said, don't trade a holiday at the beach for making mud pies in the slum. Don't do it. That's it. That's the word. Don't do that. Jesus is literally inviting him. He's inviting you and me into a relationship with him. He's saying, you don't have to sell everything you got, and you don't have to give to the poor to follow me. He said, use your wealth, okay, and be my disciple. Use your income to be my disciple. It's not about the money. It's about your affection. Ain't nothing wrong with having money. Use it in the right way. That's what he's saying. Here's where the guy missed it. His heart. He would not give his heart to Jesus. That was his greatest mistake. All this guy is the footnote in the Bible. We can use him as an example of a mistake when we come to Jesus. Don't say no to Jesus. He listens to me. He's with me. He never leaves me. What makes heaven good is because God is there. Don't make the mistake the rich young ruler made. Give your heart to Jesus. If you're a Christian, you know what you do. You don't just give it to him one time. You give it to him over and over and over every day. Every day when I get up, I got to give my heart to Jesus that day. And that's where we get it wrong. We think, I gave my heart to Jesus when I was 14 years old. Right? And that was the only day I gave it to him. Man, God has been showing me stuff and slapping me in the face and opening my eyes. You guys just, again, I could stand up here and talk about that for a long time, so we won't. But that's what we think. We gave it to him, and that's good enough. We're okay with that. That's not it. Give him your heart every day because his presence is good. The rich young ruler was literally in the presence of Jesus, and he walked away. You can walk away from Jesus. I wouldn't recommend it. Or you can worship Jesus as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Man. You know what? We got a lot going on in our world. You heard me talk about it. We got an election coming up. And I don't stand up here and talk about politics, but it's a pretty important one, I do believe. You know, and if we really want to see change in this world, everybody should be down at this altar this morning. I'm just telling you, right? We say we want it, but then we just sit here. Right? If you know somebody that's not saved, and if they died today, they're heading to hell. You should be down here on this altar, on your face this morning, giving it to God. I'm going to tell you, God, man, God has been convicting me. It's just, it's crazy. I mean, it's just, it's insane. I can't explain it. You should be praying for your family. You should be praying for your marriage. Because this world's out to take all of that away from you. Right? And maybe you here today and you're not saved. Look at me. Remember what I told you? Everybody's saved in the South, right? Everybody that comes to church on Sunday is saved. That ain't the case, guys. If you're here today and you know for without a shadow of a doubt that if you die today, you're going to hell because something's wrong in your life and you've never made that true commitment, come down here, man. I'll be here. I'll talk with you. Let's pray. Father God, we just give this time to you, God. We just pray you just move in each and every one of us this morning, in us this morning, God. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Stan, Renee's going to play with your eyes closed. If you need to move, come on down. I'm not going to wait. Bible. We got one coming up. Again, the correct, our Christian cliche, what do we say? We all say we want revival. Do you really? Do you want something changed in the world? It starts right here. It starts in mine and your heart. Man, I hope y'all are as excited as I am. Man, God can do some awesome stuff if we'll let him. Ain't no doubt in my mind. But we have to be the one that lets him do it. Just remember, those that's wanting to go are still planning on going 4 o'clock today, 4 to 7, if you're going to set up at the for the trunk or treat. Remember, Preacher D, he'll be the funeral for Mr. Theron is today at 2 o'clock, so remember him as he'll be leading the service, be with that family. Also continue to be with Mr. Dwight and Rebecca and Mr. Shipman's fighting some battles right now that nobody wants to fight, and there's probably a lot of other stuff I'm missing. But when you leave, before you leave today, tell somebody you love them. Tommy, are you closing in prayer?